reminder I hate is at night when the Tylenol wears off, and then I've got to wake up at night and treat my pain. But anyway, it's 12:35, so I'm going to go ahead and get us started. Welcome, everybody, to the Consultation Network. We do this every Tuesday at 12:30. So glad you could join us today. We have a great guest in Mickey Tonus. Actually, I think this could be a special special event today with Mickey joining us. I'm not 100% sure, but I think this is your fifth time doing this, Mickey.
It could be four, it could be 10. I don't know.
Well, this is we're treating you as if you're in the Five Timers Club today. And Babs, did you have a special gift or a special
I do. It's on an upcoming slide.
Okay. So we're going to make a presentation here shortly. But Mickey's here today to talk to us about trauma's insidiousness in support culture. What is socially valid behavior? Such a great topic, such an important topic. One that, you know, has ethical implications, but also treatment implications, I think, as we look at it. And I'm going to review an article that I did a couple of years ago regarding validation that I think fits into this, but I'm very happy to be able to have you here today to talk about this, Mickey. So thank you for being here.
Thank you, Bruce. I appreciate that. I guess I have to give an interesting fact.
Wait a minute before you do that. Hold your interesting fact for just a minute. Let me get through the rest of these announcements, and then we'll come back.
Good. Okay.
Because I don't want to storm over your interesting fact.
It's not that interesting.
All right. So March 14th, we have Patrice Coleman. He'll be with us from Nashville Department of Emergency Communications, Rapid SOS. So that's coming up next week. Then the following week, we have John Quill Newland, Tennessee Commission on Children and Youth, who will be here to talk to us. And as DIDD moves further into serving children, this is going to be really important, I think, for us to hear from John Quill. And then on March 28th, we have Dan Baker, who is a former president of the NAD organization. He preceded me as the president of the NAD organization. He's written several books on therapeutic services for people with intellectual and developmental disabilities. I'm so glad that we were finally able to get him to be our guest on that fourth Tuesday feature. So Dan Baker, Dr. Dan Baker, will be with us here on March 28th, and we're still looking at what we might have for April 4th. So everybody stay tuned for that. And please welcome today's guest, Michael Mickey Tonus. You get your green jacket today, Mickey, your figurative green jacket, your virtual green jacket. This is that they get at the Masters tournament, but you're one of our masters here on Clinical Consultation Network. So we're glad to have you.
Thank you, Bruce. And I believe I had a jacket that color in 1984.
They were popular back then. Yes.
Yes, it was. Very much so.
All right. So you were going to share with us. You might just share a little bit of your background, Mickey, and your interesting fact, and then I've got a Get Smarticle that I'll go over, and then we'll turn it back over to you.
Okay. I've been practicing behavior analysis in Tennessee since 1995. Before that, worked in brain injury, child, parent reunification, behavioral medicine, all kinds of varied experiences in grad school. So I've got 30 plus years working with humans of various disabilities and situations, circumstances in life. So this is kind of a culmination of all of that. And I wanted to preface this by saying, I've never been perfect. I know y'all don't understand that. but as we develop and observe the culture we're in, hopefully we can move forward. And hopefully I'm not saying move forward very far, but I hope I've moved forward. And this is that. My interesting fact was that when I was a senior in high school, I was president of the Catholic Youth Organization, and we did fundraisers and stuff, and we supported churches in Saltillo, Mexico. And the year I was president of our CYO, we managed to raise the most money for the Saltillo missions than any other youth group in our diocese or half of the state of Mississippi at the time, and other service projects. What was weird about that, and I sent Babs a picture. I don't know if I can pull it up. That is me at our state CYO convention where I received the Bishop Brunini Award for most service. And those are two of our adult, sponsors, the Grecos. Both have passed, but both wonderful, wonderful people.
Mickey, you're super young in that picture.
I was 17 or 18. Yeah.
Okay. I've never seen a picture of you.
Wearing contacts. and the weird thing, when I bring this around to what we're talking about, there in the Mississippi Delta, Greenville, Mississippi, we did all this service project and fundraising. And what we called it at the time was a slave drive. And at the time, none of us thought anything about it. Well, as I've grown old, and looked at the use of language and cultures and whatnot, I realized that was the most privileged thing that somebody could do to raise money for less privileged people. So I'm not looking from the outside into cultures. I'm talking about having grown up in this culture. And then as I've grown older, it's like, what was that about? Are we aware of the means and stuff like that? But that's an interesting fact, that I was youth organization president in my parish when I was in high school, and we won the state award for service by running a slave drive.
Well, that is interesting. And we are learning. We are learning all the way along, aren't we?
Now, yes, that's, absolutely.
That's critical for us all to acknowledge that we're learning more and more about how to communicate, how to respond to different situations. So that's really cool, interesting fact. Thank you for that. I'm going to share a quick, just a run through of an article that I wrote a couple of years ago. I entitled this Validated Parking, but what I'm talking about essentially is the clinical concept of validation here. And so my analogy here is on when you go into a certain parking garages, sometimes you can go into a business and get your parking validated, right? I can't recall ever having actually done that with anyone, but I've heard of that before, that you get your parking validated in that manner. Some experience that I'm a lot more familiar with is when I personally have had my parking invalidated. And I've gotten a parking ticket for parking in the wrong place. In fact, when I was in college, I parked in the wrong place every day, but the license plate was registered to somebody else, so they never knew who it was that was parking there. But then one day they discovered who it was, and I had all these parking tickets I had to take care of when I was in college. And so I'm very familiar with the concept of getting a parking ticket. One of the things I think about with the people we serve is that they're very accustomed to getting, quote, parking tickets. Lots of negative things get said about the people that we serve. Lots of invalidating things get said about the people that we serve. And sometimes I wonder if their experience is like, all I'm getting day after day, minute after minute, is parking ticket after parking ticket, being called down for things I've done wrong, being criticized for the way I am, and so on. Validation, though, is really such an important part of what we do. It's sort of, in one way, the elephant in the room Thing that we don't address enough, but that is so, so important in really being able to help people. Now, look, I accept a lot of people are going to say, look, we've all had bad experiences. We've all had criticism in our lives. We've all had negative things happen. And look, you're going to build resilience as a result of that. That's part of life that you have to deal with. The thing I want to say about that is, yes, we have all had bad experiences, but when that has been your primary experience, it's not a good starting place for trying to help somebody or trying to move them in a more positive direction. And so I go back to Marsha Linehan a lot. You know, one of the big concepts that she talks about is validation, that this is one of the key things you have to do. Now, she does say you didn't cause your problems, but you do have to solve them. That's part of it. But on the balancing side of that, you also have to come at it from the perspective that the person's doing the best that they can. And so if you're going to help somebody, you can't sit there and be saying, well, you know, you could do a whole lot better. You've got to be able to validate that position that they're in. So when I think about validation, there are a few different examples of how that can happen. And so I've got a few examples of how you can send a validation message. And Mickey, I know we're going to be talking about some examples of invalidating messages or ethically inappropriate messages, but here are a few things that can be done to validate. Be present with the person in their time of need. Tell them I'm here with you to help. You know, just being a constant object to someone, being there with them is one great way to validate their experience. Accurately reflect what the person says. For example, you're saying you miss your mother. If I'm able to hit on that, if I'm able to identify what the person is actually experiencing, that's validation, because I'm saying, okay, yeah, I understand where it is that you're coming from on something. Another thing that you can do is make an educated guess as to what the person is feeling. So feelings are one word descriptions of something that's going on inside the person. For example, you seem anxious right now. If you hit the nail on the head, now you don't always hit the nail on the head when you make those guesses. That's not behavior necessarily. It's something you're guessing at from an internal state. But if you get it right, then it's something that helps the person feel validated. If you get it wrong, you keep trying.
Yeah.
Understanding the person's behavior in terms of their history and biology. So people who have experienced trauma in particular often have changes in their brains that cause them to be persistently fearful. To experience racing thoughts, intense inner restlessness. Acknowledging these experiences shows that you understand. Example, you're speaking really rapidly right now. Are you having a lot of thoughts? Many people who have the experience of abuse have racing thoughts. And I will say that among some of the people that I've known who have these types of emotional dysregulations, when I've been able to acknowledge that fact, it's been one of the things that's helped them kind of get control of it. So it's another way of validating. And then finally, maintain an equal relationship with the other person rather than taking responsibility for the problem. Don't try to fix the problem. Help the person identify something he or she could do to address it. This is a way to minimize reinforcement for attention-motivated behavior as well. So these are just a few things to think about. As I said, you still have to solve your problem, regardless of how it came about. But what we want to do to try to help you is to validate. And so, you know, I kind of end here with this idea. We validate parking, and we want to validate people's, instead of constantly giving them parking tickets, we want to be able to validate them and help them get on a path to being more successful. So that's our Get Smart article for today. And
good choice. That,
I am going to turn it over to Mickey Tonus and let him lead us through some discussion here about some different scenarios that you identified where maybe validation hasn't occurred And to get our audience, we hope that our audience is going to participate in this discussion, maybe come in and make some comments and suggest some other ways of approaching these situations. So Mickey, with that, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Bruce. I appreciate that. I want to open this up by saying I am presenting as a learner rather than expert. Because every time I've encountered an invalidating situation, I've often frozen. You don't know what to do. And so the examples that I'm going to share are things I actually observed. I was in the room for it. And it's within supposedly a caring clinical situation. I do want to say it doesn't matter who said this, was a family member or an employee of a provider. It doesn't matter. For the purpose of this discussion, it doesn't matter what happened afterwards. Those are not my stories to tell, because I wasn't involved, if anything, in that. So I just want people to have an authentic reaction, response, anything, you know, you can or want to say about it, it's fine. That takes me to this, is that I understand that regardless of the relevance of the following scenarios to your personal example, I understand some people may have traumatic reactions. And I know that is a fact, because when I shared drafts of this, the things that I had written down that other people had said were upsetting to other people. So I'm going to apologize in advance if this triggers you. It is definitely a trigger warning. But there we go. Hold on a second.
Mickey, one of the things to make clear about the examples you're going to share, you didn't make these up, number one. Number two, they are, you're not endorsing the thinking associated.
No.
In fact, no. Directly the opposite of that. So
that's a great point. That was a note I had, is that these are not examples of trauma-informed care. This is the lived experience of providers in traumatic situations with persons that are recovering from trauma. So that's what I'm saying. I'm presenting as a learner, not an expert. These are not examples, but I'm glad you pointed that out, Bruce, because don't say these things. But wait a minute. I'm getting ahead of myself here.
Yeah.
So, okay. Next slide. What we could possibly discuss. Who sets the rules and contingencies with any organization? And then would the rule setter's behavior be, you know, using behavioral jargon, reinforced or extinguished under those contingencies? So then what is socially valid behavior and who decides? That's it. Context matters. When we are in situations and the leaders of the situation set the contingencies for behavior, if I say something a supervisor doesn't like, I need to be prepared for those repercussions. If a conservator says something I don't like, what can I do beyond just like, you shouldn't have said that? So there is no easy answer to these. I'm not giving answers. I'm not expecting answers. This is an awareness project, reflective. And to the degree that this relates to your experience, I want you to share about that. And you can be as anonymous as you need to. Let's see. Okay, next slide. Thanks. On this insidiousness of trauma support networks, because insidiousness talks about what's inside, what bubbles up and out. And it's deep, and it doesn't necessarily always mean horrible things, but in general, insidiousness is referred to horrible things. No one ever talks about the insidiousness of joy. We talk about the insidiousness of pain and trauma. And as a clinician for 30 some odd years, and I was looking at that picture, that was probably 38, 39 years ago. So anyway, but what clinicians do
on that, maybe we can take the estimate on the amount of years it's been.
Are we getting ageist here, Bruce? No,
absolutely. I can't be anybody. I can't be ageist.
Okay. What I've heard and said as a clinician over the years that we rationalize traumatizing language by claiming to vent. I'm just venting, letting off steam. Well, next slide. Sorry. Oh, you're on it. You're right. I'm looking at my notes saying this. Sometimes people say, I just need to see how people react. I want to get an assessment. Oh, I was just joking, or I was just being me. That's just me. I found out several years ago that just being me excuse is not very good. All right. So next slide. Let's see, where am I? Oh, I'm going the wrong way over here. Okay. A common metaphor is punching down. It's usually in the stand-up comic culture. When you're making jokes about disenfranchised persons or persons that don't have the same rights, privileges, or whatever you do, it's called punching down. And it's, you're basically targeting a person or group for your own entertainment and esteem. If you get laughs from other people, That is the reinforcer you're searching. So it's for your own entertainment and esteem. What I've done is reframe this. Venting is voicing one's own professional and personal limitations in unhelpful ways. I'd rather not talk poorly about someone I'm, providing consultation services for ever. I'd rather not. Venting about what angers me about this person is not a good setup for the next encounter. Seeing how people react, that is attempting to directly trigger someone's traumatic responses in unsafe environments. Board certified and licensed behavior analysts, I've been trained pretty well. If you're doing in a WADA-type functional analysis, the first thing you do is assure that you have a safe environment. Now, if people are just kind of, talking around, and then something unsafe is said, what jeopardy has everybody been placed in? So I don't buy I need to see how people react if that's going to be thrown out in an unsafe environment. It's just my opinion. I was just joking. That is straight up exploitation, in my opinion. If I'm going to make someone the butt of a joke, for what? What clinical outcome is that? So it's got to be exploitation, for lack of a better term. And then just being me. That's similar to venting, but you're voicing your own professional and personal limitations in unhelpful ways. You're off task, you're off subject, you're distracting. These are just my opinions. So that's how I'm framing that. Okay, scenario one. And I'm just gonna read this out. A female patient, all supports present were female. Supports describe some emotional expressions and relationship between crying and wanting something described colloquially as manipulating. Whenever I use things like manipulating or even threat of diagnosis, I'm using them in common terms. I'm not referring to this as a diagnostician would. So when I say manipulating, I'm not going to give a behavioral operational definition. That means what it means to you in this situation. So the comment that torqued me was, well, that's what all women do. Reactions?
I'm going to guess we're going to get some pretty strong reactions to that comment. I would encourage people to come in, because what we're doing here sounds like to me, Mickey, is stereotyping, for one thing, to easily explain something by making this comment. And you know, I think that's something, sort of a trope that people hang on to, is something like that. I'll kind of go back a little bit to this word manipulating in there, though.
Yeah.
Because here's one of the things I think I've found over the course of my career. I am interested in other people's reaction to this, opinion about it, because it's not that you couldn't classify some behavior as manipulating. I think that it is somehow not inaccurately described in that manner. However, what we're doing when we do that is essentially saying that this person's up to no good and that they're reacting in some manner that is trying to establish superiority over others or to get them to basically do what they want them to do. There are certainly elements of that in how people respond, but if I react to it in that manner, one thing from a therapeutic perspective is I've set up conflict. Made this a negative interaction that we're having. And especially if I attribute it to a statement like, that's what all women do. That's sort of like just casting it off and you know, really not addressing the issue at all.
I saw a comment it flashed, it's gone. So whoever made that comment, if you'd like to say more about that, that would be awesome.
That's Katie Klaus. She's an ISC who I know has worked with these situations before. Katie, do you want to come in and make any comment about your response there?
Well, I just feel like if you are attributing her crying to behavior, manipulative behavior, then you're basically invalidating her feelings that, you know, she's not really sad. She's trying to get something. So if you're, you know, you're basically telling her that her sadness doesn't matter. That was just the extent of it. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Go ahead, Nikki. I'm sorry.
The other thing, as a clinician, if I put all the problematic behavior on someone's genetic makeup, being a woman, I'm not going to go fix all women. So I've given myself a pass to do nothing for this woman. You know, well, there's no fixing that because that's the way she's going to act no matter what, because that is so beyond the pale, in my opinion, that I just didn't understand how that comment came into a context when someone was suffering and friendless and whatnot. It's like, well, if you quit just acting that way, you'll be all right. That's kind of, any other comments? Anybody want to chime in?
Well, I would just say one. That's what you just said, Mickey, that, yeah, it's sort of like saying, well, clinical services don't really matter at all because this is just part of who you are.
Yeah,
it can't be changed. Now, there are certain aspects of people, you know, like if they have an autism spectrum disorder, you accept that. That's part of their basic way of functioning. But this is stereotyping in a bad way. We have another comment.
Yeah. And somebody? Anna or
Babs, you want to?
Hi, sorry. I had just said that it brushes off the actual root of the problem and not trying to get down to what the root of it is, because maybe there's a communication error, like she doesn't know how else to ask for what she needs. So this is her way of doing that. So if you actually sat down and talked to the person, you may come to find that, oh, there's like a deeper thing going on here.
Yeah, correct, correct. Yeah, that's really good point. And I forgot what I was gonna say. So if no one has anything else, we'll go to.
The only thing I'm gonna say in response to that though is, you shut all that down. You shut all understanding down when you make this comment, because it ends there. Oh well, we've explained it all. So now we can move on to the next frame. That's not good clinical work. So,
and it's not funny. It's not funny. And if the intent was to joke, it's not funny. That's one thing I wanted to bring in real quick. All the articles I researched for this getting to the punching down part, talked about how DSPs are doing the wrong thing and how we need to fix them. Well, DSPs operate in a culture, and at the top of the hierarchy are the ones that set the mores of that culture. So if I read every article about insidious trauma and trauma care, and they talk about how we need to fix DSPs, I hear that as those people. I need to say, what do I need to do? What do I need to do to set a better example, or a good example, if you're at the base, you know, that kind of thing. So the whole punching down, that's also that's what all women do. You know, that's how they don't have the skills that we do. And that's so offensive to me that I just can't say anything more about it. But if we don't have any other comments, we'll go to the next scenario. Okay, male, person described as delusional. Let's give it, he got bitten by a spider when he was younger. He didn't die. Now he says he's Spider-Man, and he goes by the name Peter Parker, you know, occasionally. So, but all this information was available to the team before. Introductions are going around, comes around to this one person, says, "Nice to meet you. I'm the president of the USA.
And I assume it wasn't the president.
No, it was not. But in this, it was kind of interesting to me in that situation was, here's someone that's presenting with, once again, in just vernacular common day language, of delusional, not diagnostician, and someone reacts to that in an equally delusional manner. Where do you go from there? And I'm not saying the person said they're president, believe they're president. It's just, where do you go? Where do you go? Any reaction to that?
Yeah, we'll open it up, see if people have some reaction to that comment.
If not, I got a better one.
Yeah. One of the things with anybody who is delusional, though, our goal is to try to help them be oriented to reality.
Yes. And yes.
So if that is, you know, to the extent that this kind of leads it off in a different direction, you're obviously not accomplishing what you would want to accomplish in this circumstance.
Let's just apply the situation of, I just want to see what happens. And just because someone is delusional about their own being doesn't necessarily mean they buy into my delusions about me. And so if someone introduces himself as Peter Parker and, you know, does this, nice to meet you know, like he can shoot webs, I'm not going to say I'm the Incredible Hulk and I'm going to, you know, bash you. That's just inappropriate, in my opinion. It's not funny. It's contrary to what anybody would recommend anyone do with someone that's presenting in a delusional manner. Like you said, Bruce, we want to ground them, we want to bring them in reality, talk about stuff that's actual. And so it wasn't funny, and I could not find a psychological test that validated that in any kind of safe or unsafe environment. You know, if you read the book, the Three Jesus of Ypsilanti, that's a lesson in ethics itself. So no more comments. We'll go to the next scenario. Female, difficulty building and maintaining relationships and with some dependency or codependency, once again, common language in the support team. Comment, well, you just need to watch this Netflix series on coming of age so you can just learn your accurate age.
Hmm.
Say more about Bruce. What?
Well, I'm just, I'm a little bit puzzled about how that is going to help you act more your age, coming of age. But I guess those movies do tend to help people. They're advancing, so that's what they're trying to get across here, is that in one of these series where somebody's coming of age, it would be a way for you to see how that happens.
And you know, we're talking about coming of age movies. Most of them, except for you know, the TV show from the 80s and is now resurging, they all contain lots of risque scenes, behavior, and they're not necessarily connected in a way like a course would be, or a workbook, or a, you know, webinar. They're just shows about stuff, and how one picks what is age appropriate versus what's not age appropriate depends, one, on whether or not you have IDD in many cases, and two is what your life experiences tell you about that. So this is a recommendation. When I heard that, I was like, well, what are we going to do with that? Just sit around and watch TV and then what?
Yeah. Well, you know, so a little bit of counterpoint on that. I don't exactly, this is so generic that it defies a little bit of, you know, how I would probably react to something. But I do think that there are certain experiences people can get through media that can be helpful to them. You know, you can think about some of the series that are out there that give you good fodder for discussion with somebody. And especially if you were going to facilitate the experience, especially
that's a good point.
It would really be a good learning experience. The way this is phrased, I think, first of all, doesn't take into account the person's developmental level. First of all, and so in that way is invalidating, because you're not acting your age, essentially, is what you're saying. And this is something you need to do. To make this, for me, more validating, it would be a circumstance where, okay, this might be a good experience to watch this and then have us discuss it some. Watch an episode of whatever the show may be. There are so many of these shows about people with disabilities that I love, that I do think are could be a wholesome experience for somebody if not treated cavalierly in this manner.
It's interesting to bring that up, because that's really hitting the heart of what I'm talking about. Those shows are probably more helpful to those of us that are working in the field to provide, you know, trauma-informed care and effective therapies and stuff like that, to teach us ways of recognizing when we need to express compassion or empathy or strength or whatnot. But just to tell someone to go watch this show.
Yeah.
I just don't get it. This is pretty benign.
Very, very invalidating.
What I want to bring though, and Bruce, I'm glad you brought up, like this one could be either way. The insidiousness of trauma, inducing responses doesn't have to be a physical assault on someone. Just little, invalidations throughout the day. It's like, oh, you're not acting your age. Let's just stop there. Because that's what you said, and that's pretty, in my opinion, invalidating. All right, yeah. Let's go to something that might be a little hotter for folks. Okay. I had to put my name in here, just because me. But there's a male with impulsivity, sexually inappropriate verbal behavior. The comment was, hey, let's go have our session at Hooters, and I'll bring Mickey so he can chaperone.
Yeah, that seems very counterintuitive.
Yeah, and it's one of those situations of, let's go here to see what happens, regardless of the safety and security of that environment. So if I want to take someone who's impulsive with sexually inappropriate verbal behavior to a place where that's expected, then what's expected of me in reining that in before someone gets hurt, whether socially, physically, or whatnot. So it's just that kind of thing. Was that funny? Was that qualified therapy? What was the purpose of going there other than to create discomfort among other colleagues, in my opinion? Last scenario, but I think we should open this up to a general discussion then, because these scenarios you may not relate to. So I would like to go to the next slide then. Let's see. There. That is the privilege of the elite. When you can say, hey, bah, 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 bah. But don't tell anybody I said that. Hey, guess what? Bah, bah, bah. These kinds of things are always said into the air, never written down. So it's like, oh no, I never said that. That kind of thing. But it's those are cues that you may be treading into hot waters. If things that are said in an unhelpful manner are just simply said rather than shared in a recorded way, you're in a quagmire. You're getting in a mess here. But I would like to move this on to just reactions. What's going on with the crowd? Where are y'all with these kinds of things?
I'm interested if other people have other examples, maybe of times where
that would be awesome.
Some of these things happen. I was thinking a lot, Mickey, not just about these types of scenarios, but other scenarios like where, for instance, we're trying to, somebody's going to be moving from one place to another, and we don't want to tell them about it until they get to the new place because we don't want to be upset about it in advance. This is, just another example of how people become invalidated, learn to not trust others.
Yeah,
I think a lot of the things you've been talking about undermine the trust between the person and others around them. Just as another example of how that ends up happening is that we don't communicate honestly with people.
Say I was a program coordinator and we're having a staff meeting, and these are the things I'm saying. What should I expect, the direct support professionals to do after that? If these are the kinds of things, so It's the domino effect. Trauma is not necessarily a direct assault. Sometimes it is an indirect assault through, you know, your direct support professionals, your colleagues, other folks, and it just keeps going on, going on. The concept of venting with other clinicians, and I've done it. I'm not saying I've never done it. What that really does is it skews the other professionals' opinions of that human being with whom they're going to work and who needs help. And so if I'm going to vent, I need to find it in helpful words in some ways.
Yeah. So just kind of exploring that a little bit, Mickey, so you confess that you've done it. I think we've all vented in that manner before.
Yeah.
Probably a lot of times we vent among our family members or our coworkers sometimes. Mm-hmm. I think from my perspective, a lot of times I'm not taking it very seriously. It's not as if I'm adopting that as a point of view. It's kind of just, acknowledging the circumstance or the stress that we're all under because of a different, a situation that we may be facing or dealing with. And I just wonder, I'm just curious as to your thoughts on, because I do see how that can get certainly far out of control. But is there a valid mechanism there to kind of be able to, among your peers, share a little bit and maybe blow off a little bit of steam, as I've heard people say before?
I think so, but I'd like someone in the crowd to give us an example of when they found themselves in a venting situation and how that was handled. Somebody has anything? I mean, I can chime in, but these were my experiences. I don't know your experiences. So has anyone got a time when someone's venting and it just wasn't helpful? Okay.
I can think of a lot of times that's
happened. I can too.
I can tell you. I can think of a lot of times where people have done that. And I probably, here's the sort of other side of it is that I feel like at times I've invalidated that person, though, by negatively reacting to what they've said, because people, I think, do need an opportunity to be real sometimes about things and to say things. I don't know. This is kind of a back and forth here on this aspect of it, because I don't know, how do other people feel about that? I know everybody out there has done it, so we don't have to entertain any thoughts that we haven't all done it. I would say that there have been clients before where I get frustrated and I just, say, well, I can't get through to this person. So, you can't get through them to them, or whatever.
Yeah. I'm going to chime in. Yes. And there are helpful and unhelpful ways of venting. The words you just chose then were, I'm frustrated and I don't know how to get to this person. Rather than in a psychological report I read for somebody years and years, like one of my first days here, for a young guy in a community living situation, in his psychological report, he's somewhere between Dopey the Dwarf and Jason the Axe Murderer, and I'm like, this is an official report. And after that day, I no longer read any psychological reports for folks I was working with until it came to discharge kinds of things, because I did not want to be ruined that way. I did not want to go in expecting to see Dopey the Dwarf with an axe. I could not do that out of respect for the person, respect for myself, and respect for the field. That was probably my third week on the job, and so I didn't say anything to anybody about it. I just ignored the report. That was not venting. But venting, and you nailed him, Bruce. Say, I am frustrated. I am having a hard time. You're taking the burden on what you can do rather than pawning off on, oh, that's what all women do. You're just stuck. I see the screen lighting up. I don't know if those are
your comments. Yeah, we just got a comment. I'll read it.
Let's do it. Let's go for it.
It's from Sarah, and it says, venting with dignity. We are constantly trying to supply a dignified experience to our clients. This is a great reminder to continue the dignified mindset, even through frustration or within a venting realm.
I'd like to hear a little bit more. Do you have an example of that? And you can make one up, but I'd like to hear what's going on.
Sarah, if you want to come on and talk about that, that'd be great. I don't know if you want to.
No pressure. Well, while we're waiting, I want to say that when we do talk about these things, we're not in a bubble, and our actions have an effect on everyone around us. And if I'm going to walk in a situation where I'm concerned that there may be some traumatic reactions, I want to be more careful about what I'm saying. I'm not going to, guess person's motivations, except outside of my operational definitions of venting and all that kind of stuff. But it's ways of being helpful. And I've found that when I use helpful language about the folks with whom I'm working, I feel better about myself. Yeah. So I'll take that.
That's good stuff. Well, listen, Mickey, I appreciate you coming on and talking to us about this day. I think it is, as Sarah pointed out, a great reminder to continue that dignified mindset as we're working.
Yeah.
Because that's a way of giving others dignity as well. And, even with the fact that we've all done it, we all know that it's not helpful to continue talking in these ways about people. And so I really applaud you for bringing this out today. I congratulate you on making the Five Timers Club. I really appreciate your participation in the Clinical Consultation Network. And so thank you so much for being here today.
Oh, thanks for having me and letting me vent in hopefully a helpful way.
You go. And thank you to everybody else out there, all our participants in the Clinical Consultation Network. We do it every Tuesday at 12:30. Join us again next week, where we'll have another exciting presentation for you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank y'all.